Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration
24/7.
This is UBM Praise. The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Okay, ladies, do any of y'all want to hang with Sir Walter Jones on Today?
Yeah!
Oh, we don't want you. Please don't come. No, I'm just joking. You can come along.
Totally.
I got a special treat for you this evening. A young man that you all know is Joe the Policeman. From the What's Going Down episode of That's My Mama. I want you to put your hands together and welcome him to the stage. Big round of applause.
Let's go.
That's Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
That's Sir Walter Jones.
What's his name?
That's Sir Walter Jones.
Whose show is this?
That's Sir Walter Jones.
Who is it?
That's Sir Walter Jones.
Say it again.
That's Sir Walter Jones.
Who are you with?
That's Sir Walter Jones.
One more game.
That's Sir Walter Jones.
The Sir Walter Jones Show with co-host Alvin Carter. We are a Christian talk show in which we tackle all the hot topics in a believer's walk. It's Theology Thursday. If you love the Word of God, grab your Bibles and let's see what thus saith the Lord. Join Elder Jones and Pastor Carter in some good old-fashioned Bible study.
Guess it's true, I'm not good at a one-night stand. But I still need love, cause I'm just a man. These nights never seem to go to plan. I don't want you to leave, will you hold my hand? Oh, won't you stay with me? Cause you're all darling, stay with me. Why am I so emotional?
Scott just made the point. Jeff Jefferson used to be a lot more secure. Not just.
In the past few weeks, America has witnessed high-profile acts of bravery that would leave even the founders of this nation, even America's heroic defenders, slack-jawed with wonder. Steel yourself now for two profiles in courage, Sam Smith and Bruce Jenner. I'm PJTV's Scott Ott, joined now by the bold Stephen Green and the daring Bill Whittle. Men, Sam Smith, though a Brit, has set an example for our nation's youth when he took home four Grammy Awards this week. His hit ballad, Stay With Me, was named Song of the Year. In it, his falsetto voice pleads with a one-night stand partner that he needs love because he's, quote, just a man. And he begs his fleeting companion to hold his hand and linger for a while. Sam sings, this ain't love, it's clear to see, but darling, stay with me. Now, of course, I was stirred by the depth of his noble and heroic passion, and so I sought to learn more about this great role model. Little did I know, the song was addressed not to a sleazy woman, as I had assumed, but to another sleazy man like Sam. And Sam Smith boldly wants the world to know it.
Yeah, so I came out at a very, very young age, and then I kind of felt like I just had to mention it before I released my record, just right. So people knew that the record was who it was about.
Mm-hmm.
And it felt like a brave thing to do as well. I wanted to do it before.
Yeah.
Because people would have thought, if I did it afterwards, people probably would have thought I was lying just to sell records,
right.
Which wasn't the case.
Say what? So at the risk of his own record sales, he tells the world that these are songs of homosexual longing, and even so, he won several Grammy Awards. By the way, he's not just bold, but he's smart, too. Sam Smith told the Daily Beast, I've tried to be clever with this album because it's also important to me that my music reaches everybody. I've made my music so that it could be about anything and everybody, whether it's a guy, a female, or a goat. And everybody can relate to that. In fact, here's Sam at the Grammy ceremony singing his homosexual cuddle anthem as a duet with the lovely Mary J. Blige.
Stay, 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 stay.
Well, of course, he's singing it to a woman because, I suppose, goats don't sing very well. Bill Whittle, the official Stay With Me music video has been seen more than 232 million times on YouTube. I'd like you to talk about the courage it took for Sam Smith to tell us up front that he was singing about same-sex yearnings and the statement of courage that the music industry made in showering him with awards.
Well, first of all, let me just say this. I know that like both of you guys, when I saw the clip of him on the Ellen show revealing that he was gay, I fell out of my chair. I mean, I just couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it. If he hadn't come out and told us that he was gay, I was speechless with shock and surprise. I think this is kind of the thing that we're getting at here, right? Is, you know, the courage of coming out gay in 2015, seriously? I don't have anything particularly against this guy. In fact, I don't have anything against him at all. I don't care. You want to sing a song about wanting a little human connection to unnamed humanoid form number 329 who's lying in the background of my video, then that's fine. That's swell. You can do whatever you want to. It's a free country, and I don't begrudge him any of that. You know, I started working in the theater when I was 15. I've been surrounded by gay people my whole life. None of this stuff matters to me. What does bother me is this idea of this kind of thing being like an act of courage on a par with Kyle Smith or something like this. You know, the courage it took for him to come out in 2015 with his earrings and his pompadour and to reveal to the world who, again, the collective gasp that rang the planet like a bell when this guy admitted he's gay. I mean, seriously, can we just please get over ourselves on this issue, honestly? If you really want to talk about courage today in 2015, if you want to talk about coming out as an act of courage, one of the people you might want to talk to about this would be a person I admire enormously, and not just because he wore orange and blue, but you just ask Tim Tebow about what it takes to have the courage to come out in 2012 or 11 or whatever as a conservative Christian. And look what the world did to him. Look what the sportscasters did to him. Look at what was said about Tim Tebow versus what was said about the guy whose name escapes me, who was the first gay NFL player.
Michael Sams.
Thank you. You know, one of them got a call from the president for his courage, his incredible courage in coming out. He got on all the talk shows and everybody fell down and bowed down before him because of his incredible courage. Tim Tebow comes out and says he believes in God and Jesus is his savior. And he's vilified and flayed and is a laughingstock of jokes for years and years and years and years and years. This is a guy who was doing, you know, this is Tim Tebow, just as an example, is a guy who could have lived. Could, just given his occupation, his looks, and his position, could have lived a life in the pit of the flesh that would have made pretty much anybody envious. He decides to spend his summer in the Philippines, you know, building houses for poor Filipino people. So Tim Tebow, just as an example, was living the kind of life that these liberals love to claim that they're so much, you know, in favor for. They got a bumper sticker on their car about it. Tim Tebow's year after year after year doing missionary work in the Philippines, and he's vilified and demonized. And this kind of thing is praised. It just, you know, I don't have anything against the guy being gay, but really an act of courage, I don't think so.
God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Thursday. Hello, everybody. So welcome to the So Walter Jones Show. How are you? Good to see you on the radio. This is Thursday, Theology Thursday, where we come together and teach out the Word of God. But today we're going to take a little detour. As you heard the intro of our thing here, it is Bruce Jenner has caused some problems. He didn't start it. It has been going on for many years, many decades, centuries. It's just that Bruce Jenner is now the postal child. He's a pinup guy, girl, whatever y'all call him today, of this deception. We're going to talk about the transgender. We've done our homosexual shows. We've done about three or four of them already. You go to Spreaker.com if you're not there already, and you can hear our shows on the gay agenda. Today, we're going to call it the Bruce Jenner Effect. We've been doing a lot of effect shows, mainly on music. We've done effects on Edith Bunker. We've done effects on, the Cosby Show. We've done effects on The Jeffersons and Good Times. We've done all these effects. And then we turned around and did the effects on music personalities like Kirk Franklin, Andre Crouch, Mary, Richard Smallwood, and a few others, I'm sure. Clark said that already. Yeah, we're calling these effects because we want to find out what is it that these people, these personalities, these actors and actresses, what did they do to affect us as a people? This is a Christian show, and everything that happens in America affects us some way, form, or fashion, whether it's positive or negative. Today we're calling it the Bruce Jenner Effect. Again, he didn't start it. We have a few people who did kick it off, and they were kind of celebrated. But Bruce Jenner has opened up the eyes of many of us who live in a moral body, living in an immoral world. It brought us awareness of where the world is today. Bruce Jenner is a cross dresser, or he's changing. He's more than a cross dresser. He's a transgender guy. So he's a cross dresser first, yes, like RuPaul is. But RuPaul is not a gay man. He's not a homosexual. Bruce Jenner says he's not a homosexual. He likes women. He just likes to be dressed as a woman as he's approaching a woman. Okay, and this is a very, very serious show. We don't want to laugh or make jokes of this situation, because I believe a lot of this is both mental and spiritual. And we'll talk about this. I have some articles, and I have some people on Facebook have chimed in. And gosh, David Rodgers, I have an article from him. He can't be here today, but I've got his writing, so it'll be like he's here. Okay. And so let's go at the beginning. Again, you heard the soundbite at the very beginning talking about these are three men who were talking about this whole Sam Smith situation. He was singing "Stay With Me." It was a great song. When I heard it, I'm like, oh, this is so beautiful. I can just play this and play this. And then when he told us who he was singing it to, it had this effect on us. It's amazing how you guys know songs, you know writings from books. You have bought people's material. You've bought their clothesline. You bought their chicken. You bought their cars, and you didn't know what their stand were, and you were enjoying their products until you found out who they were. Then you begin to throw out all of their products. You begin to turn off their songs. You begin to do these things, and this should be a show in itself. Why is it that we are like that towards people, and especially those who are of the LGBT community? Why is it that I feel that they are more deplorable than the other sins that the Bible talks about? And we're going to go from Romans 1 today, and we're going to go from 1 Corinthians 6 starting at 9. And to talk about, it gives you a bucket list of all the sins. But that sin of homosexuality is a taboo, especially in the black church, and we can't even shake their hands without having to go and wash it. It's just amazing how we treat them. So this is not a show on acceptance at all, but it's a show of awareness of what's going on, their agenda, how it's affecting America, and how it's splitting us even in the church today. So we have to break down the acronyms, as we've done on a couple of times on our homosexual shows. The LGBTQIA, and notice that those letters, each letter, they keep adding letters, put it that way. They got QIA. They got to keep adding letters because they have, because others who decide they want to be something that God did not make them, there's a place for them to go. I remember an old cartoon back in the 70s. I think it was, who's the guy with the red nose? Rudolph. All right. Rudolph has shows. It was Rudolph and then the Rudolph Shiny New Year. I think one was special. And they had a place called the Island of Misfit Toys. And that is an island where all of the toys that just did not make Santa's sleigh. I don't know. The elves just couldn't make them the way that they should have been made. And so this island was made for them. And it was a place where Rudolph and his friends went because Rudolph was rejected as well. And he found a home and peace at this island of misfit toys. Well, the LGBTQIA is the island of misfit toys. It is a place where people who were born a certain way, and they decide that they don't want to adhere to, well, let me put it this way, because I have to explain what these letters are so that I can go where I was getting ready to go. There are people who are born, we are born in sin, all of us are, and we are susceptible to all kind of decisions that sin can bring to us. We could become murderers if we want to. We can become fornicators, adulterers. We can become liars and thieves. We can become homosexuals. All of these things are given. It's putting our face in. We are susceptible to dive into any one of these corners if we want to. All right. And then what happened was Jesus came and he died for the sins of man. And he says, and through this death, we have an opportunity now and we have a right to receive him. And in him, we can be cleansed of these things that we were born of and turn to him, allow him to keep us in the straight and narrow. Unfortunately, because morality has been hidden and buried in the sand in the United States, man is being turned over to these things that he desires. He's been turned over to his lust. And he's given into his lust, and after that comes death, as the Bible says. Again, we'll have to reference Romans 1. God says, if you continue to do it and you are full of it says, and be careful to understand Romans 1. It says, once you're full of it, then God says, I'm going to turn you over to it. He says, I'm going to turn you up and then over to it. What's called a reprobate. And so the LGBTQIA and another letter will be added, I believe, is probably going to be, I think it's going to be, P is going to be added later, and that's pedophile. It will be okay to be that, and the people will, men that have formed a group, the pedophile group, who wants the same rights as these people here. So L is lesbian, of course, we know what that is, but actually you have to break these down into also their types of each one of these letters. And again, this is a very informative show today, as all our shows are. You know, we at the Sir Walter Jones Show, we do not put everybody in hell because we don't want to go there either. But what we do is we educate you on what these people, who these people are, who they're trying to become. And then we don't focus so much on the person. We focus on the people around them, on how they are affected by them. Because the church is, how could this church be split on homosexuality or transgender and all this stuff? Well, it's because the spirit of the Antichrist is here. The principalities and demons and Satan and all of his army, they're here to influence us in our mind. And it used to be a time that the church, our founder of the church, Bishop C.H. Mason, used to pray for the minds of the saints. Y'all stop praying for the minds. So in your churches, there's a lot of mental illness in our churches today. And we just think people are having bad days, but a lot of that's mental illness. And you guys are just ignoring it and you don't know how to deal with it. So as it pertains to the lesbian, there's five types of scenes of a lesbian. One is called the butch. OK. And their traits is they have shaved hair. They have baggy jeans and they have a disdain. They said they have a disdain for knitwear. OK, that's a. Yeah. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It says most likely to be insulted if you call them bisexual. Uh-huh. And least likely to own a pair of heels. Their calling card is multiple cat owner. All right. And that's the butch. These are the lesbians. And then you have what's called an athlete. Their traits are killer abs, competitive attitude, superfood, smoothie recipes. They're most likely to have fancied their school sports teacher. They're least likely to eat trans fats. Lesbian calling card is sportswear. They're a sportswear addict. All right. That's the athlete lesbian. There's the next lesbian called the boy babe. Their traits is Justin Bieber hair, dungarees and DCs and minimum makeup. Most likely to have a fast paced career. Least likely to consider floral dresses acceptable. Their lesbian calling card is designer eyewear. Okay. That would be Ellen DeGeneres or Ellen Page. Those would be boy babes. Okay. Let's see. And the athlete would be Kelly Holmes or the L word. All right. Let's see. Jane Lynch would be the butch. Okay. Y'all know these people, right? Good. Then you have what's called the lipstick lesbian. Their traits are quirky fashion, liquid eyeliner, long hair. Most likely to follow Christine Stewart on Twitter. least likely to drink a Lager. L-A-G-E-R. Not Lager. Sure. Lager. Okay. Beer. That's beer in it.
Yeah.
The lesbian calling card, their colleagues think they're straight. Their colleagues think that they are straight. All right. Let's see. That would be Portia would be one. Lauren Prepon as Alex Vogue on OITNB, whatever that is. And then there's the alpha lesbian. Traits are short quiffed hair, terrifyingly unapproachable. Most likely to have at least 4 tattoos. Least likely to ever talk to me. The lesbian calling card is turning straight women. Wow. And they're saying that the alpha is Rihanna, the gay years, Shane, and the L word. All right. And that's the breakdown of the lesbians in that whole thing. All right. And some of you are saying, why are you telling me this? Because you guys are friends of some of them. You just don't know what to call them. And you might be insulting them and you don't know why you're insulting them. So that's the L is lesbian. G is gay. Of course, we know what gay is. Usually referred to men. B is the bisexual. That's men. And that's women or men who like both women and men. All right. Then T, of course, is transgender, who we're going to talk about today. Q is not queer, okay, because queer could be anything. But Q is questioning, actually. They're concerned. They're questioning who they really are. I is intersex, and that's the person who's born with two of the hermaphrodites. So the proper term is intersex. And then A is asexual. Now, why they're on the list, I can't tell you why. Because this is a person who don't prefer either or. They live a happy life, not having to worry about attraction and sex. So why are they on this list of LGBTQIA, I'm not sure. So digging deep into this, because again, we're going to get to Bruce Jenner in a minute, but we want to, in order to get to Bruce Jenner is not the start of it. Bruce Jenner is only, I wouldn't even say the end of it, but he is the result of everything that happened prior to him. Okay. And I'm not going to refer to him as a her nor Caitlyn. That's Bruce Jenner. That was his birth name, and he's still a man. Even if he decides to change his form, he will still be a man in the eyes of God and creation. But it is a confusion is what it is in the mind. It's confusion. I have a file that I have played called The Confused Gay that we played a couple of times on the show, and we always get new audience, new listeners on the show at Sir Walter Jones Show, and we thank God for that. So what we're going to do is we're going to play a person here who is apparently a lesbian, but she is very confused on what sin is, and this is the world that we live in today. Confused gay.
People think
I'm gay. I'm not gay. I'm not gay. I don't be on no gay. I'm a lesbian. Gay is when two studs. What you mean? Like, that's gay as two studs for each other? Like, really? Really? Like, y'all going past gay. Like, y'all going extremely gay. Y'all going too gay. Like, I don't know. Like, y'all really, like, literally jumped over the rainbow and just got stuck on some gay. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's like double sinning. It's already a sin when you're a lesbian, which I am. Everybody sin. God died for our sins. That's what it says. God didn't die to double sin for us to double sin. You know what I'm saying? I play that lesbian, but that gay killed me with that. I don't be on that. Like, straight world probably confused. Like, okay. Like, for instance, you straight, right? You and your nigga been before marriage. Most of y'all, not everybody. You know what I'm saying? That's a sin. You're before marriage. You sinning already, but that's a normal sin. You know what I'm saying? Not saying you allowed to do that, but it's just normal. It's a normal sin. It's a common sin. But if you go and double sin, like you trifling, like I hope you catch something. Double sinning is when you go multiple niggas. Like you got a nigga and you going around the corner to go multiple niggas. That's double sinning. If you're going to sin, you sin the right way, not the wrong way. I'm sinning the right way. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I know I'm gay. That's a sin. And I go, you know what I'm saying, a few other gay, they films. I'm going, but guess what? I'm sinning the right way. I would never double sin. I would never go and go to the other side. Like, they went to the other side of the rainbow. I'm not with that. Like, that's double sinning. You know what I'm saying? Miss me with that. Know the difference between gay, lesbian, sin, and double sin. I know my difference.
Yeah, she knows her difference. And again, some of you are shocked, those of you who are just hearing this for the first time. This is normal. Her attitude, her belief on what sin is normal in that world, believe it or not. That's not a normal world, but in that world, it's normal. Does that make any sense to you guys? It probably will after the break. I want to play a file in place of music. I'm going to play this file called Bruce Jenner, Heroes of the Civil Rights. That's right. All of this mess is turning into a civil rights struggle. That's the world we live in. We'll be right back. So on the Jones Show.
Log on to UrbanBroadcastMedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered.
Well, some of you may remember Bruce Jenner from a 1970s Wheaties box. He was an Olympic gold medal decathlete. But Nicholas Kristof of the New York Times says Jenner's alleged impending announcement that he's becoming a woman is much more courageous than training and competing for Olympic gold. Kristof says this in his column, "All I know is that Jenner seems to be preparing for a bold public mission involving something intensely personal in a way that should open minds and hearts. So in my book, Bruce Jenner is now a gold medalist again. Come on, Wheaties, it's time to put Jenner back on the box." Now, Stephen Green, how eager are you to pour your boys some Wheaties from a box featuring a lovely feminine picture of Bruce Jenner and then have that talk about real courage?
You know, I don't actually care about that much. I'll get to Bruce Jenner a sec. First, I want to talk about the song. You know, about 15 years ago, George Michael recorded just a wonderful album called Songs from the Last Century, which were these kind of a smoky jazz club covers of favorite songs of his from the 20th century. And he had a recording on there of My Baby Just Cares For Me, which is a beautiful song. It's a beautiful performance. Of course, George Michael being gay, he switched some of the
George
the
Michael is gay?
I know, it's shocking, isn't it? Anyway, he switched some of the words around in the lyric to let you know that his baby is actually a boy. And it doesn't really matter. It doesn't change the fact that it's a great performance of a great song. This song we just heard has a banal lyric with absolutely nothing, no great sentiment to express. The singer's phrasing is uninspired at the very least, and the music is just pedantic and dull. It's not that he's gay, it's that it's a bad song. I can't believe that is what wins a Grammy these days. Anyway, that aside, you know, Bruce Jenner, this isn't necessarily bravery. What this looks like to me is exhibitionism. He's made himself re-famous in the last few years by surrounding himself with surgically enhanced women, and now he's going to become one himself in the public eye. I don't know if that's bravery. I do know it's exhibitionism, which is usually a cover for not having anything real interesting going on in your life.
George Michael's not gay. It's a lie. It's a lie.
Go buy that record. It's beautiful.
Oh, I can't bear it.
48 hours ago, I didn't know anything about Sam Smith, but I immediately hated his best song of the year before the end of the first verse. It's immoral. It's infantile. It's just pathetic. And then I watched the official video and noticed that Sam wears earrings, two of them, in the shape of the cross. Not that he's a Christian. He just likes the look. He says he wants to be, in his words, iconic. How ironic. I then saw that he shot much of his homosexual snuggle ballad in a church building with a faux gospel choir backing him up. Sam told Rolling Stone magazine, "I believe in God, but I don't know what it is. And if it's a he, she, or anything, all I know is that I feel that there's something else there." End quote. Now, perhaps that's the real appeal of Sam Smith in this generation. He wants to make love with no commitment, make music of no consequence, create a caricature without character, and make God in his own muddled image. Likewise, Bruce Transgender gets lionized for destroying an American icon. They are the antithesis of courage. And frankly, both men need prayer, care, and some genuine love. But it suits the soul-sapping culture corroders to give them platforms, trophies, and fame for shame. For Bill Whittle, Stephen Green, and the entire trifecta crew at PJTV.com, I'm Scott Ott.
Sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't. Almond Joy's got nuts, mounds don't. Almond Joy's got real milk chocolate, coconut and munchy nuts too. Mounds got deep dark chocolate and chewy coconut. Ooh. Sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't. Peter Paul, Almond Joy's got nuts. Peter Paul, Mounds don't.
Because
sometimes you feel like a nut, sometimes you don't.
Yes!
It's happening all around the house, right about now.
I'd like a Triscuit.
I'd like a Triscuit.
I'd like a Triscuit.
I know my family, and when they'd like a snack, they'd like a Triscuit wafer.
Great with cheese.
Or with a dip.
Neat with jam. Or just by themselves. And they really are good. Triscuit wafers, they're made from 100% natural whole wheat. And that's good, too.
A Triscuit, baked only by Nabisco.
Aww. Hey, this is Julie Norwood with 60 seconds of cool inspiration for your day. Have you ever had a grandiose plan that was just waiting to be executed, but then an unexpected event happens, and without notice or concern for your plan, that event shows up and holds your agenda hostage? I'm sure you've had a similar experience, and it stinks to say the least. And if you don't give it special concern, your heart can become bitter and your feelings will get caught up. So the lesson in the curveball is realizing and accepting that your plan isn't going to happen the way that you thought, planned, or even hoped. Make peace with that fact right away. It will save you a lot of frustration when you do, I promise. And secondly, when an unexpected plan sabotages your agenda, allow it. While you may not put the welcome mat out right away, there's wisdom in allowing the unexpected to unfold in your life. That's 60 seconds of cool inspiration with Julie Norwood. For more inspiration, check out my webpage, julienorwood.com. God loves you, and he has an awesome plan for your life.
I'm gonna pray for you.
The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
Hi-ho and welcome back.
Welcome back.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life. Here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Oh.
you all say, yeah. Speak, Lord. Speak, Lord. Speak to me.
Welcome back, everybody. So, Walter Jones. Yeah, they went there. God, speak to us, because I'm writing a book now. I have a title, and I'll reveal that title soon and very soon. Preparing for my concert, my anthology concert coming July the 6th. Y'all come check me out, but y'all be hearing our commercials soon and very soon. But I want to talk about... let's talk about pride songs, okay? I'm going to bring this up because, again, we were very informative show. Here are some songs that when you hear them, when you heard them back in the day, they were just beautiful songs that you danced to, or you just maybe was riding down the highway in the car to, or riding your bike, or got a Walkman in your ear. And they were just cute songs of the 70s, 80s, 90s, and maybe even the 2000s, depending on your age. But today they have turned over into what's called pride songs. They're songs that the gay community has used now for them and them only. So when you hear it now, it's like that Sam Smith song we just heard. Once you now know that what it's used for, even though these writers did not necessarily write them for the gay community borrowed them. Now we can't touch them anymore. So let's see. I got a few there, and let's see if I can find out what the name of the song. Maybe you can too. Let's just play them as we go, Dion, and see if the audience could tell me what's the name of the song. Okay, anybody know what that is? Anybody know the title of that song right there? I do know that ABBA, yeah, it was one of the greatest groups. They were from Sweden, I think it was. Somewhere over there. Well, that's a Dancing Queen, okay? That is now a pride song. So if you got it in your iPhone, and your yeah, that means if you're listening to this song, okay, let's go to the next song. See if we can figure this out.
Oh no.
Oh well, this is a big one from their community. And I don't know. I think I've even heard Diana Ross said she did not know that they were doing this to her song. She said she was kinda honored by it. Although that's what she said when the TV cameras are rolling. Now, if Ivan was here, I'd ask him what was he doing around this time. I think Dion was scratching records around that time. Okay, let's go to the next one. What's this? Oh, this was the disco era, 1970s, Donna Summers, Last Dance. Great song back in the day, but gotta erase it out your iPads and your iPods and your MP3 players. What's the next song?
Wow.
Oh, wow. Ain't that something? I know by the strings, by the strings. I just upset a few of you. I'm so sorry. Yeah. They took that song too. Next.
Of course.
At first I was afraid. I was petrified. Kept thinking I could never live without you by my side. But then I spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong. I grew strong and I learned how to get along. So now you're back.
Now you notice the contents of all of these songs, the struggle of that lifestyle. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What does she got? Uh-oh. Well, we know about these boys. They were the true village people. Okay, and they did it again. The first one was Macho Man, wasn't it? Yeah. And this one here is, well, this one here is a place that I live up the street from this place. Young Men's, I think it's Christian Association or something. Yeah. YMCA. I can see them doing the whole YMCA dance. What's this?
You with the sad
heart. See? You see how they're taking these beautiful songs here and turning it into their own identity. Poor Cyndi Lauper. I think this is True Colors, right? Yeah. Mm-mm-mm. Yeah, we lost another one. Okay, what is this? Oh, that's their king. I think that's George Michael, man. Oh, boy. He was like, wake me up before you go-go. Okay, I think that's called Freedom. What's this? Oh, I know by that beat what that is. I can see the video. That's Madonna. I think that's called Vogue. Not the magazine, but yeah, Strike a Pose.
Yes!
Okay. Yeah, get that out of my ear, man. Get that out of my ear. Oh, wow. That's a group called Soft Cell. You see, I'm an 80s baby. I know. Tainted Love. It, yes. Perfect name, by the way. What else we got?
It doesn't matter if you love him or capital H-I-M. Just put your paws up. Because you were born this way, baby.
Lady Gaga, she said, you were born this way. Great deception. I think I got one more now. Because I get that out of my ears. Now, I was really heartbroken about this song here. This is Christina Aguilera. The song called Beautiful, which is a very beautiful song. A beautiful song. But when I saw the video, I said, well, I think I know where she's going here. Because you saw pictures of anorexia. You saw pictures of a black person, an interracial couple. And then you saw a picture of, I think it was two men kissing or something like that. It was a homosexual in there. And then I realized what she was trying to do. Basically, she's calling everything beautiful. and that's the whole premise of this show here, is that the world has called everything beautiful. Almost everything is beautiful. Even in how we celebrate television and motion pictures, how the villain, the bad guy, the murderer has become someone that we applaud and we celebrate that person. For instance, and I think it's subliminal type thing, it's psychological. One of my favorite miniseries on tape on TV, it's been off the air maybe a year or two now, it's the meth show, Walter White.
Breaking Bad
is, I think, is the best miniseries there ever was. And because it tells a story, I think they went six seasons or something, like six, seven, I can't remember, but he started off as a really nice guy, and then after a while, before you know it, he's this murderer. And you didn't want Walter White to hurt. You didn't want him to die. You didn't want him to, you know, you wanted him to continue in his empire. And it's amazing how the writers could turn us from someone who loves something so dearly to loving them even more after they've turned to some dastardly way. We've been set up by people like Bruce Jenner. We look at it started with maybe Chaz Bono, which really opened up our eyes, but it didn't really start with him, but it really opened our eyes with Chaz Bono's. Okay, and then you look at our president, President Obama, and his wife, who said they were against homosexual marriage, but because someone close and dear to them came out, their children had friends who had come out, then what it did, it turned their hearts. And that's how you have to be careful of the deception, is the battle is about the heart. It's really, that's all it is. The battle of good and evil is towards the heart of man. And if you can get the heart of a man, you got everything the man owns. Everything, the total man.
What about Dustin Hoffman and Tootsie?
Yeah, okay. Well, that, you know what? We got over that. That Dustin Hoffman and Tootsie thing, that was so minor and what have you. Although, when it kicked off when was that? Late 70s, early 80s maybe? Mm-hmm. Okay, that was kind of, you know, innocence in a sense back then. It was in the movie. Okay, it was real life, but we didn't see it real life because they were still, a lot of men and people were staying in the closet. But Tootsie's situation was, you know, he was trying to beat someone that to win another girl. So that may not fit here, but you look at men, how we could get the woman's heart, and then we got everything everything that she owns. Okay, and again, this battle is the heart. Bruce Jenner was worth $100 million before he became this Caitlyn person. That's how much he was worth, $100 million. He is now projected to be worth, his net worth, $500 million. Somebody said priceless. His net worth now is $500 million because he decided that he didn't want to be a man anymore. He wanted to be a woman. And he's been celebrated everywhere. I want to read an article from Ori Pansion or something like that. I saw on Facebook. It says, please, it's a time to share my opinion. I'm pretty blown away and disappointed in the fact that the Arthur Ashe Courage Award will be presented this year to Bruce Jenner. It is scary to think that we now live in a society that makes their decisions on what is trending instead of what is right. How can the ESPYs overlook Lauryn Hill, who battled cancer while courageously playing the sport she loves until the end of her beautiful time on the earth? The way she lived her life has and will continue to inspire others to never stop living your life. How can they look past Noah Galloway? This real hero put his life on the line every day so that we could live safely in America and so Bruce can play dress up. While fighting for our freedom, Noah lost his left arm and leg, but through adversity, he continues to courageously compete and fight every day of his life. Finally, let's look at Jim Kelly. As an athlete, he was already a hero to many, And when cancer came knocking on his door, he punched it right in the mouth. Jim showed people that it's okay to be scared, but it's not okay to give up the fight. This man has shown courage. If the SBs wanted to give Bruce Jenner, somebody said Cross Jenner, an award for his sports accomplishments, then I would back them 100% because he truly was an exceptional athlete. But to call him a hero and courageous for having plastic surgery and wearing women clothing simply because he is not happy with the way he looks is a complete disgrace to the Arthur Ashe Courage Award. If Bruce truly wants to be known as courageous, then make this right by not accepting the award and give it to someone who actually exemplifies courage. And that's a very deep, a deep saying, and I totally agree with it. But let me dig into this Arthur Ashe Award, okay? Bruce Jenner, it says Bruce Jenner, he will receive the award, but he's joining 9 other inspirational winners. Now, I want y'all to pay close attention to the ESPYs on the people that they have given these awards to. And notice these people very closely. First of all, he's with Michael Sam. Okay? Y'all know who Michael Sam is? Mm-hmm. Sam came out as gay while a football player at the University of Missouri and later became the first openly gay player in the NFL. He won, okay? He won the award in 2014. Now, next is Muhammad Ali. Ali won the Ashe Award in 1997 and then opened the nonprofit Muhammad Ali Center in Louisville, Kentucky, okay? The organization emphasizes personal growth and social responsibility, all right? Then come Nelson Mandela, all right? So you got Muhammad Ali, Nelson Mandela, and then you got Michael Sam. Now watch this. Billie Jean King. The Arthur Ashe Courage Award is just one of the accolades that tennis legend King has won for personal strength. She's won the Champion of Justice Award from the Public Justice Foundation and the Presidential Medal of Freedom. She's also active on behalf of the Women's Sports Foundation. Then you got Robin Roberts. Okay. Does this anything... Is anything happening to y'all's mental state here? Patton, Kevin Tillman. You got George Weah, W-E-A-H. Okay, so you got Robin Roberts, Billie Jean King. You got Michael Sam. Now you got Bruce Jenner. Anything popping in y'all's minds? Okay.
Yeah.
Well, don't say that in front of Eric Jewel Hayes, nor say that in front of Joe Hill, because they're telling you that's not true. I'm not going to go there. They say it's been debunked, and even the Chicago Tribune said no. You know, I was messing with them on Facebook. I was stirring up the pot. they was defending him to the very end. Man, they got so upset with me. But Joe Hill says first, he said he posted about Bruce getting an ESPY nomination over Lone Hill. Then he says, I compared in another post how he or she was being praised, but a teacher who gave a kid free lunch was fired, and how twisted our values are. The names I've been called make the abuse I get from Sir Walter Jones like a day on the beach. we love Joe Hill on the show.
Yes!
Let's see. Wendy King says, so after the news media is merely using this man as a spectacle to submerge many Americans into a lifestyle of blatant immorality. People are actually being baptized into this nasty sin, immorality, not knowing that the devil is cheating them out of life of immortality with Jesus. Then she says, and his mind is so messed up, he's just loving the attention he's getting, poor thing. He wasn't getting enough attention when he was a Kardashian. That right there punked him out. While married to Chris, he took on another man's name, Bruce Kardashian. That's what she's saying.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. But she said something earlier that I did wanted to quote, if I can find it. how she was saying something about he's this spirit that's in him. Let me see now. It's here somewhere. Okay. And she wrote so much. Something pushed Bruce to give in to the demons that were trying to possess him. Unfortunately, Bruce is not alone. Many of us at some point in time gave in to demons that tried to dominate us. But thanks be to God, they didn't have the victory because of Christ, who made a way of escape. Yet Bruce and many others like him, trapped in any sin, didn't have what it takes to escape. Hopefully this too shall pass for him, and his eyes will come open for him to submit to the truth. And then she mentions Darlene's name. Let's see. Principal Keter says, even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind. We're going to go there today, Principal. Thank you. The spirit of prophecy is being revealed more and more. We should not be shocked by anything we see. That is so true. Let's see here. I was trying to see where, Wendy was talking about, y'all know Sasha is that person that lives inside of, Beyonce.
Sasha Fierce.
Yeah. So now Caitlyn lives inside of Bruce Jenner.
Well, it might be the other way around.
It might be. Mm-hmm.
Bruce is on the inside.
Yeah. Caitlyn, yeah. Right. You know what I'm saying? That is, ain't that something? That's a good point, Dion. That's a good point. we're not going to say a name because the angels might sing. But A. Scott says, I wish that I can say I wasn't born with an irregular heartbeat. She says, unfortunately, I was. My point is, even though this is what I have to, it's still up to me to maintain and preserve what God has given. Now, y'all listen to this very closely, okay? Ooh-wee. God created me to be a girl. And guess what? This is the way I'm staying. There is a soap opera I'm watching that has a transgender storyline. Years ago, Lee Phillips would have never approved it. Now we live in a day and time when all genders has to be portrayed in mainstream. The church world is next. She says, never mind, I decided to copy and paste. But she's right. The church world definitely is next, and the LGBT community have a mark on media, which means they are making sure that their actors and the gay personalities are played in all of our TV shows today. There's every show you can think of right now that's popular, there's a gay figure in it. It's because the LGBT community came forth and said, you better have it in there or we're boycotting. The church can't put a Christian person on any of those shows. Not like because we can't stand the way they do. We're undivided. We are divided, that is. We're very divided. I think the person who can sing us into a sense of awareness with Christ is Thomas Whitfield right now. We were scheduled to do Thomas Whitfield's show yesterday, but we could not because of the passing of my co-host's mother. Alvin Carter's mother passed yesterday, and we're giving our love and our thoughts and prayers to him and his family. And so I want to dedicate this song here, Thomas Whitfield, to the memory of Alvin Carter's mom, Mrs. Carter, who was an extraordinary pianist and singer, and who taught and introduced Alvin to Thomas Whitfield's music. This song's called We Need a Word from the Lord. We'll be right back, y'all. Sir Walter Jones Show.
Broadcasting all over the world at urbanbroadcastmedia.com. Delivering love and inspiration
24/7.
This is UBM Praise.
We don't need another conqueror on the scene. What we need is a special word
that will burn within our hearts and give us direction. From above, we need a word from the Lord. A word from the Lord. Just one word from the Lord will move all the doubts and cause the sun to shine and give peace of mind. Speak, Lord. Thy wisdom and thy understanding. Though we lack the very love you show in the sun. Lord, we've altered in thy ways, and we stand so much to gain. So give us your word, Lord. Speak, Lord. Just one word from the Lord will move all the doubts and cause the sun to shine and give a peace of mind. Speak, Lord.
Pickles,
cheese, lettuce and onion, sesame oil, seed bun.
I think they're describing a big...
To all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions, on a sesame seed bun.
Say that again.
To all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions, on a sesame seed bun.
To all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, onions, pickles, onions, on a...
McDonald's Big Mac. The big sandwich with the great big taste that everybody's talking about.
Sesame seed bun, and we forgot the onions.
Yes, it did. Yes, it did say onions.
Are you sure?
It said onions.
All right.
To all beef patties, special sauce, lettuce, cheese, pickles, onions, on a sesame seed bun.
McDonald's Big Mac. The great big sandwich with a great big taste.
Lettuce. Pickles. Cheese.
Big Mac.
You deserve a break today at McDonald's.
Where your dollar gets a break every day.
The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
And now, our feature presentation.
Jones! Say what to Jones!
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
Hey everybody, welcome back. Glad you're still here. Not sure why. I'd have shut me off a long time ago. But you're here and I'm glad. I'm thankful. There's so many of you who have really inspired me all the time. You give me messages and inbox messages and what have you, and tell me how informed you are. There's some people who are studying for their master's and PhDs and what have you, and you guys have used my show as a ladder. I mean, it's just amazing some of the stuff I hear. Matter of fact, I'm going to read a message that you got today. It says that I saw someone on Facebook that is supposed to be a leader in the church supporting his bravery, saying only God can judge him or her. And she's like, stop this madness. She says, my daughter is 9 and I was looking at something on TV with my sister. We were at her house. I was doing my my daughter's hair, and this show comes on with the two gay girls about the fashion. My daughter was so disturbed. She said, Nanny, can we please turn the TV? That is not right. Those men dress like ladies and trying to act like ladies. She says, I had nothing but the utmost respect for my daughter at the age of 9 to know what's right and what's wrong and not want to be a part of it. And again, this is, and the people are trying to make it acceptable. They're forcing the acceptance on America, and they're trying to force it on your children that it's okay. And a lot of these groups are going into your child's schools, and they're doing presentations like Career Day. You know, it used to be a time you saw Officer Friendly walk in the class, or a fireman or a policeman walk in there with his outfit on, talk about what he does. Well, the LGBT community doing the same thing. They're coming in there and they're talking about what it is, and they are trying to bring again the acceptance of it all. But let's talk about gender identity disorder. All right, let's see what the proper meaning of it. This is GID, or dysphoria is what it's called. It's a former diagnosis used by psychologists and physicians to describe people who experience significant dysphoria or discontent with the sex and gender they were assigned at birth. Right? Evidence suggests that people who identify with a gender different from the one they were assigned at birth may do so not just due to psychological or behavior causes, but also biological ones related to their genetics, the makeup of their brains, or prenatal exposure to hormones. Estimates of the prevalence of gender identity disorder range from a lower bound of 1,200 or about 0.05%. In the Netherlands and Belgium. Oh, okay, and all these numbers probably don't mean nothing to you, so I'm gonna read the rest of these. Gender identity disorder is classified as a medical disorder by the ICD-10-CM and DSM-5, called the gender dysphoria. Now, some of you will be hearing these letters and numbers after this show if you haven't already. You're going to hear transgenders on CNN, MSNBC, and Fox, and what have you. Well, you may not see them on Fox. They don't play them games. But you're going to be seeing these transgender talk, and they're going to be calling out these DSM terms, okay? So pay close attention to them, and go to Google and the God of the Internet and see what they're saying about it. But many transgender people and researchers support declassification of GID because they say the diagnosis pathologizes gender variance, reinforces the binary model of gender, and can result in stigmatization of transgender individuals. All right. The official classification of gender dysphoria as a disorder in the DSM-5 may help resolve some of these issues. because the term gender dysphoria applies only to the discontent experienced by some persons resulting from gender identity issues. And I said this was a mental disorder on Facebook, and they dug a well and threw me in it. And I really don't care. The current medical approach to treatment for persons diagnosed with gender identity disorder is to support the individual in physically modifying the body to better match the psychological gender identity. Basically, what they're saying here is the only cure for Bruce Jenner is that he continues his transformation and get his hormone injections and get his breast implants and his hair and his heels, and that will cure him. That will treat him, in a sense. Not so much cure, but that will treat him. All right. Again, how do you treat a murderer? You give him a gun, plenty of bullets, supply him with enough weapons of mass destruction to continue doing what he needs to do, and that gives him a high. Yeah, how do you treat an adulterer? You make sure you have plenty of married people coming in and out of his house, that so that he can be treated properly. All right. Now, some of y'all saying, that's a horrible comparison. No, it ain't. I'm in scripture. That's not a horrible comparison. How do you treat people who decide they don't want to do what God has assigned them to do? You allow him to do what he want to do, and you enable him. How do you cure a person who's hooked on drugs? You continue to supply him with drugs, basically, so that he could be satisfied. So it's saying here that this approach is based on the concept that their experience is based in a medical problem correctable by various forms of medical intervention. And it goes on and then talks about the signs and the symptoms. Okay. Symptoms of this GID is children include disgust at their own genitalia, social isolation from their peers, anxiety, loneliness, and depression. And, you know, when we talk about the American Psychological Association, which really is a group of people who can't make up their mind really what they want to do. But I listen to them. I agree with a lot of their findings, because I believe that you can't disagree with everything the science scientists are saying, because you live in a science world. Everything that you do is about science. God is science. He's I'm not science. That's what we call him. So we can't disagree with everything. But when they bring up things that is immoral, that goes against scripture, then you have to disagree with it. I don't disagree with global warming. I really don't. But many of evangelicals do for some reason. Homosexuality used to be known as a mental illness. It was stated and classified by the American Psychological Association that it is a mental illness, and they had to reverse it. They had to change it because many of the APA, many of them were gay. And so they didn't want to be known as somebody that was crazy. So they figured, let's change this. Well, transgender is going through a process. They keep changing the rules, because when acceptance come to a world, then you have to change the rules, and you have to either raise the bar or you have to lower the bar to accept immorality in, to allow acceptance to come in. For instance, look at the what's the group that regulates cussing on television? You know, the censor, FCC. Yeah, FCC and the censorships. Used to be time you couldn't use the word the D-A-M-N on TV, but now that's a common word. Now B-I-T-C-H is being used freely on there. Matter of fact, I was watching one show. They could say D-I-C-K. They could say D-I-C-K, but they couldn't say cock. They were fused. This was on cable TV. I could not believe it. They bleeped cock, but they allowed D-I-C-K to be mentioned on TV. So what is it saying? Things are changing. And it's going to be time with now you'll be able to say anything because this we're living in that world today, the prince of the world. So adults in that this world, the GID, are at increased risk of stress, isolation, anxiety, depression, poor self-esteem, and suicide. Studies indicate that untreated transgender people have an extremely high rate of suicide attempts, One study of 6,450 transgender people in the United States found 41% had attempted suicide. This is shocking. That's why I didn't want to make fun of these people, because they're killing themselves for this, compared to a national average of 1.6%. It also found that suicide attempts were less common among transgender people who said their family's ties had remained strong after they came out. But even transgender people at comparatively low risk were still much more likely to have attempted suicide than the general population. Transgender people are also at heightened risk of certain mental disorders, such as eating disorders. And so notice that they're calling transgender a disorder. But those who are transgender don't want it to be known as a disorder. They don't. But yet it is. Then they're giving you the biological causes of this, this genetic differences and what have you. And you guys can do your own homework, because we can go into a lot of deep stuff. Then they give you the diagnosis. The American Psychiatric Association permits a diagnosis of gender dysphoria if the criteria is the diagnostics of Statistical Manual of Mental Disorder, 5th edition, or the DSM-5 are met. And it goes there. I do have a file, though. I do want to play CNN. They were fighting. There were four guys. There were four people on this show, three of which were of the LGBT community, because the host of that show, I think, is Don Lemon. He, of course, he came out gay. And then he had a transgender person. Then he had Perez Hilton, the guy who writes those blogs. We know he's gay. And then they had a woman on there. You know who's going to win. Okay. Dion, let's see if we can play that file and from the mouth of a transgender.
We'll continue this conversation. Okay, we took a breath. We're having a very heated conversation about Caitlyn Jenner. Back with me now, Zoe Turr, Crystal Wright, and Perez Hilton. And these conversations are going to happen, and they're happening around the country. Zoe, pull this back on the rails for us. Go ahead.
Well, one thing, some of your guests are conflating publicity with something that's very serious. Gender dysphoria is a brain anomaly. You can see it in MRI scans, CT scans of the brain. This is a brain anomaly that can only be cured, only be fixed with hormone replacement therapy, and for many, sexual reassignment surgery. So this is something you treat with hormones. And Jenner does suffer from gender dysphoria. Jenner has received the diagnosis, has two medical clearance letters. It's the same thing I have went through. To conflate this with some sort of publicity seeking behavior is absurd. The way Jenner is packaging this and packaging the transition may be a different story. You can argue about the way they're rolling Jenner out as a product, but the underlying issue, and then also quoting some troglodyte that calls this a mental illness, is absurd. And the DSM has changed that.
That was changed in 2012, right?
Right. So what we're talking about is a very serious issue, where we have up to 69% of trans people or transsexuals attempt suicide. So we're talking about staggering numbers. Yeah. And to get into a yelling match with a Crystal, who's obviously a narcissist, and an entertainment show person with a blog site, conflating this is absurd. And it's not helping move the issues forward.
Yeah, Zoe, you know I love you, but let's not call names. I understand, Crystal. A lot of people feel the way you feel. I just don't understand your comparisons, and I don't want to beat up on you, mm-hmm. but I want to.
Well,
do
no,
you think
I mean,
that most people in America understand, though, what Zoe is saying? That it's not, you know, it's not what people think it is. This is a medically diagnosed
right.
condition.
Well, I think Zoe makes some really good points, and I think it is a medically diagnosed condition, but I'm not going to name call this, because I'm not going to challenge what Zoe feels and believes, but I have a right to believe what I believe in, and that's Zoe started off the conversation by saying that she was very bothered by the sexualized pictures of Bruce Jenner. I mean, I'm sorry,
I didn't
Caitlyn.
Say that.
Okay,
she,
well,
no,
I
asked her.
Did not
she
say
said,
that.
Yeah,
she didn't say
you,
she was
you did,
bothered.
You, Zoe,
no, she
you
said,
said
she
that
said
they
that
were
they
over,
were very. No,
well,
she
maybe
didn't.
I heard.
She said
I
they were very
else.
Sexualized.
You can't
were,
hear when you're talking.
Well, you're talking over me. I was trying to answer a question.
Okay,
but,
let's. But let's have a constructive conversation.
Okay, I'm trying to have a constructive conversation, Don. I didn't interrupt Zoe. My point is this. I do not, and I have a right to my perspective, and I think a lot of people who maybe come from a different point of view, who haven't struggled with being transgender, look at what Bruce Jenner is doing, and I don't think that he's not, that I think he is Caitlyn now. I believe that. That's not what I said. I don't like the fact that he is capitalizing off of this, doing it in a very public way. I know a person who is going through this struggle. Might surprise you.
You know, it's like saying you know a black person. And she is a she now.
Can you
excuse me? Caitlyn Jenner is a she.
Actually, the person I'm talking about is not a she now. I said I know somebody.
Caitlyn Jenner is a she.
What bothers a lot of people like me and Eric Arison is exactly how you're behaving, Zoe. We do not agree with what Bruce Jenner is doing. I think some of it, I think Caitlyn, believe is who she is today. I think she did this in a very calculated manner to make millions of dollars to pay for her Malibu home, her Porsche. I find it repugnant.
Caitlyn acknowledges,
and I don't think it's
she's
helpful
got a mortgage
to transgender
pay. There's
community.
Nothing wrong
and
with that. There's
I,
also no roadmap
I
to how you
right
should, you know,
to
transition
do
in public.
Renee Richards, who was one of the first people to go through this in a very public way, Renee Richards, who you all may know, famous tennis player, has now come out and advocated against the surgery because she said that she believes that she still doesn't
I've
feel matched. And Renee, and there's a lot of scientific evidence that shows that when
I'm
people
so
have the
sorry
sex operation, they commit
I
suicide.
I have to go.
Okay.
And as Zoe said before, not everyone is going to do it in the same manner. So
right
when there are trans people now coming into the spotlight now, people will do it differently. And that's what progress is about, diversity, even within the trans community.
Yeah, it's a mess. It's just a mess. Now you got the transgenders and the gays on my news stations fighting over Bruce Jenner. Even their world is divided.
I'm gonna pray for you.
Yeah. Funny thing about division though, Satan's kingdom's never divided. Beelzebub can't cast out Beelzebub. Jesus said, can't do it. Their kingdom is always on top and none of them are divided in that world. It's just amazing. Psychological treatments here, it says until the 1970s, psychotherapy was the primary treatment for this disorder. And generally was directed to for helping the people adjust to the gender of the physical characteristics present at birth. Psychotherapy is any therapeutic interaction that aims to treat a psychological problem. Okay. I studied psychotherapy. I had a little short stint studying it on my own. It was amazing, absolutely amazing. It helped me understand some people in my church. Really did. I had to choke on that one. Realization came to me and I choked. Though some clinicians still use only psychotherapy to treat GID, it is now typically used in addition to biological interventions as treatment for GID. Psychotherapeutic treatment of GID involves helping the patient to adapt. Y'all notice that, right? Attempts to cure transgender by changing the patient's gender identity to reflect birth characteristics have been ineffective. Did y'all hear that? You want me to say it again? Attempts to cure it by changing the patient's gender identity to reflect birth characteristics have been ineffective. That means if you're trying to tell them this is how you were born and you need to stay this way and treat them that way, they say it ain't working. It makes you wonder what's going on in the church today. I keep bringing this up because it's a Christian show. But John Hopkins, psychiatrist, y'all know him. He's saying transgender is a mental disorder. Sex change biologically impossible. Uh-oh. I'm about to read this because this should be interesting. I haven't read it yet, but I know it's got to be interesting. This is from the CNSnews.com. Dr. Paul R. McHugh, the former psychiatric in chief for John Hopkins Hospital and his current distinguished service professor of psychiatry, said that transgenderism is a mental disorder that merits treatment. that sex change is biologically impossible and that people who promote sexual reassignment surgery are collaborating with and promoting a mental disorder. Did y'all hear that? Now, this is not a church. This is not a religious organization. Okay. And when I said it, they slammed me to death. But here is a well-known organization here, John Hopkins Hospital. Okay. Dr. McHugh, the author of 6 books, at least 125 peer-reviewed medical articles, made his remarks in a recent commentary in the Wall Street Journal. He wasn't hiding, y'all. Where he explained that the transgender surgery is not the solution for the people who suffer a disorder of assumption. The notion that their maleness or femaleness is different than what nature assigned to them biologically. Okay. Whew. Yeah. He also reported on a new study showing that the suicide rate among transgender people who have reassignment surgery is 20 times higher than the suicide rate among non-gender people. My goodness. Dr. McHugh further noted studies from Vanderbilt University and London's Portman Clinic of children who had expressed transgender feelings, but for whom, over time, 70 to 80% spontaneously lost their feelings. Wow. While the Obama administration, Hollywood, and major media such as Time magazine promote transgenderism as normal, said Dr. McHugh, these policymakers and the media are doing no favors either to the public or the transgendered by treating their confusions as a right in need of defending rather than as a mental disorder that deserves understanding, treatment, and prevention. This intensely felt sense of being transgendered constitutes a mental disorder in 2 respects. The first is that the idea of sex misalignment is simply mistaken. It does not correspond with physical reality. The second is that it can lead to grim psychological outcomes. The transgendered person disorder, said Doctor, is in the person's assumption that they are different than the physical reality of their body, their maleness or femaleness, as assigned by nature. It is a disorder similar to the dangerously thin person suffering from anorexia, who looks in the mirror and thinks they are overweight. This assumption that one's gender is only is the mind in the mind, regardless of anatomical reality, has led some transgendered people to push for social acceptance and affirmation of their own subject personal truths, said this doctor. As a result, some states, California, New Jersey, Massachusetts, have passed laws. They're barring psychiatrists, barring them, even with parental permission, from striving to restore natural gender feelings to a transgender minor. Ain't that something? They want you to accept them, and they got the world to accept them. And now that y'all accepted them, you can't change it. And the world is going to attack you. But if you come out as a Christian, you will not receive a phone call from the president. I want to hear from Erica Campbell. She's singing about changes. Still on the Jones Show.
On to UrbanBroadcastMedia.com and check out the many services Urban Broadcast Media provides. Whether it's social media, video production, radio broadcasting, or audio recording, we got you covered.
Spring turns to summer and summer to fall. Fall turns to winter for sure. Seasons change. Joy and pain, life is full of meaning. Change. Sometimes it's hot, sometimes it's cold. Change.
do you see that some things were not meant to be? We make our plans, but it's all in God's hands. Life is full of many changes. Sometimes it's hot, sometimes it's cold.
Freshens breath longer than Big Red.
So kiss a little longer, hug a little longer, state your case a little longer, longer with Big Red. That Big Red freshness lasts right through it. Your fresh breath goes on and on while you chew it. Say goodbye a little longer, make it last a little longer. Give your breath long-lasting freshness with Big Red.
Yes!
Butter.
What was that?
Butter.
Parquet margarine.
Butter.
No, parquet. It says right on your lid, parquet margarine.
Butter.
Parquet. Smooth. Delicious. Butter.
Parquet.
But surely, Starkist don't want tunas with good taste. Starkist wants tunas that taste good.
That's for me.
Sorry, Charlie.
Hey, this is Julie Norwood with 60 seconds of cool inspiration for your day. Have you ever had a grandiose plan that was just waiting to be executed, but then an unexpected event happens, and without notice or concern for your plan, that event shows up and holds your agenda hostage? I'm sure you've had a similar experience, and it stinks to say the least. And if you don't give it special concern, your heart can become bitter and your feelings will get caught up. So the lesson in the curveball is realizing and accepting that your plan isn't going to happen the way that you thought, planned, or even hoped. Make peace with that fact right away. It will save you a lot of frustration when you do, I promise. And secondly, when an unexpected plan sabotages your agenda, allow it. While you may not put the welcome mat out right away, there's wisdom in allowing the unexpected to unfold in your life. That's 60 seconds of cool inspiration with Julie Norwood. For more inspiration, check out my webpage, julienorwood.com. God loves you, and He has an awesome plan for your life.
The following show is paid programming and does not necessarily express the views and opinions of Urban Broadcast Media and its subsidiaries.
Thank you for listening to UBM Praise.
The Word of God is powerful, often misunderstood, but with proper study, you can gain accurate application of this potent source of life here on the Sir Walter Jones Show.
If I were you, I would say, yeah.
Welcome back, y'all. We're going to rush through here as my throat hurts because I've been I just got over a cold, but it's not good in the throat. This last part of this article says sex change is biologically impossible, says McHugh. People who undergo sex reassignment surgery do not change from men to women or vice versa. Rather, they become feminized men or masculinized women. There you go. Claiming that this is a civil rights matter and encouraging surgical intervention is in reality to collaborate with and promote a mental disorder. You're promoting it. And there were all these, everybody on my news, CNN, MSNBC, and Fox were celebrating this man to the point of giving him an award and telling him, you have encouraged me. I mean, these great men and women who have done things in life are saying this guy, because he decided to put on women's clothes and get implants, that is the most inspirational thing they've been a part of in the last. It's just amazing how deception has creeped into our world. Men have called right wrong and wrong right. T.C. Williams, Pastor Williams, will be here tomorrow. Is it Williams or Thomas? Okay. Pastor T.C. will be here. He says that the Christian is becoming obsolete in their views because we have allowed so much to enter into the church that we are the minority and are lessened when we speak from the Christian point of view. So true. Everything's in the church. You don't even, the only way you know you're in a church is because there's a steeple. There might be some pews, and there might be a cross. There's some stained glass. That's when you know you're in church. That's about it. The people, not so much. Tomorrow we're talking about Jesus. Is he Republican or Democratic? That's tomorrow's topic. It's going to be crazy. You in a wig party? Is he wearing, Jesus wearing a wig? Yeah, we're going to talk about that. It's going to be crazy. Tamara Miles is saying, who is Bruce Jenner? Wait, who is Bruce affecting? What about any in the picture? I put a whole bunch of pictures up there. Who will they give account to? Certainly not us. I'm not able to hear she's talking about the show, but thank you, Tamara. Wonderful host, by the way. Co-host who come on our show a few times. But let me move real quickly because I have some people I want to read from them what they had to say. David Rodgers had a wonderful article he put up. He said this is the Bruce Jenner controversy. He says the Bruce Jenner controversy. He says I refrain from saying anything about this situation because frankly I didn't deem it worth any of my time. Being up in prayer all night has shifted my heart as the Holy Ghost has challenged me to speak from the apostolic dimension to the body of Christ in the world. And first of all, I want to give our condolences and prayer to David Rodgers, who lost his father, right? Is his father? Yeah, lost his father the other day, and we're praying for his strength. And so he categorizes as, one, the challenge, number two, the church, then the image of God, then the kingdom message, and then he says, what I believe. And it's a great, you guys go on his page because it's a lot here. He says the challenge is the entire story and its buildup has been decades in the making. I told y'all that. I haven't even really read through all of this, but that right there, I just said. The 40-year moral slide in the country from the free love movement in the 60s to the LGBT tsunami of political rebellion here recently has been the elephant in the room for some time. Each decade, introduction more and more, gross perversion in the lines of morality eroding with each introduction. As Bruce has undergone his transformation to a woman and the subsequent introduction to his altered personality, we are left with millions of questions and opinions both in the church and outside the church, not only for Bruce, but for the billions around the world that are being seduced into accepting perversion as valid. And then in walks the church, he's saying here. The church, leaders in the church are demanding that the body of Christ just love Bruce. Pray for him. And don't judge him, are the mantras of the day. The church is asking to pray, love, and accept. This because God is love. Let's examine this line of thinking of scripture to see if it carries any weight. And then he subtopics this, the image of God. Often in these conversations, the responsibility of love for love is demanding of the church and never the offending party that has chosen to rebel against God. At the church, we love people enough to tell them the truth. Truth is not relative. Truth is not adaptable to whomever chooses to manipulate it and fit their sinful lifestyle and stubborn opposition to all that is holy. When God created man, he created him from his image. Genesis 1:26. Bruce was created by God as a man. To suggest that somehow God made a mistake that requires a man to fix is absolute rebellion and blasphemy. It is the highest level of dishonor one can unleash. When we accept that our God can sin, this thought and behavior seeks to lower God, to make him equal to us and subject to adjustment. Bruce has been married and fathered children. Due to his failure to address this demon of duality at work in his nature, his children suffer the lack of strong identity and moral aptitude that real fathering is designed to produce. Is it a wonder why his children bounce from sinful relationship to sinful relationship? Is it a wonder why vice, addiction, and pornography were the gateways to their family's fortune and acclaim? At what point did the church introduce the world to repentance? And then he subtopics this, the kingdom message. Matthew 4:17, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. This is the first message that Jesus preached. This is the message that John the Baptist preached. So why is the church changing the message? We don't find the prophets of the Old Testament or the apostles in the New Testament demanding believers to preach love to sinners. The message has always been repent. To place the blame for sin, sinful behaviors, birth from sinful thoughts and sinful strongholds of the church ability to love is absurd. Human love doesn't change people. Transformation begins with repentance, which means to change the mind. Until demonic desire is confronted with the power of repentance, sin will continue to have dominion over people. All of sin must be discarded, and the new image of Christ must be embraced. The old man must die, and a new man must be born. Matthew 3:1. Sinners must repent and then love God by accepting the lordship of Jesus. Romans 1:16. There is no allowances for sin. Grace doesn't give us the right to practice it. Bruce Jenner is in sin and bondage. He and others like him are prime candidates for salvation and deliverance. It's a matter of the heart. If Bruce loved God, he would seek God and place the needs of God above his own. Bruce would ask God to deliver him, and God, out of his mercy, would do so. The Apostle Paul, prior to his conversion, was named Saul. Saul murdered Christians. Nowhere in Scripture do we see Saul continuing to murder Christians. After his encounter with God, Acts 9:1, too many times we give allowances where God demands repentance. Bruce Jenner has submitted himself to the devil and the lie that has been embedded in his soul for 65 years. Bruce's selfish, self-centered decision was made. Despite the love of his ex-wife, children and family, and the love of God, he flaunts his new identity for the world in magazines to feed demons of rebellion, witchcraft, perversion, homosexuality, and confusion. Romans 1:18, in which I had more time to read that. The double-minded displayed through his life and throughout the body of Christ is troubling. I have no responsibility to condone his actions or the actions of anyone who willfully chooses to rebel against God. My responsibility is to love them enough to scream, repent, at the top of my lungs, to a world that has adamantly denied the God of their salvation. And then he goes into what he believes. Okay, and it's a great one. It's on my page. You guys go there or go to David A. Rodgers on Facebook and read it again. It's been shared many times. And then Ricardo Ivory sent me something. It says, the body God gave us doesn't lie. A meditation on the sexual confusion of our day by messenger Charles Pope. And this is a lot. I can't read all of this either. You'd have to go on my page to read it. But the latest tragic twist in the Bruce Jenner saga, more on that below, illustrates yet again one of our great errors of the day, the rejection of the truth that our bodies have something to tell us about who we are and what we are called to do and be. Most moderns see the body as merely a tool of sorts. Assertions are made that one can do as one pleases with their own bodies, and that is person's sex, male or female. Is purely incidental. Merely an arbitrary quality one happens to have. Many say that our sex should not speak to anything deeper than genitals, and that other mere physical differences are to be set aside to one degree or another. In effect, it would seem that our bodies have little or nothing to say to us, according to the modern culture that that are incidental. The rejection of the body as instructive or in any way determinative has reached its zenith in the attempt that normalization of homosexual activity. Yeah. The redefinition of marriage. And now, sexual reassignment surgery. Whew, man, this article is deep, y'all. As regards homosexual acts, any non-ideological analysis of the body will indicate that the man was not made for the man, nor the woman for the woman. Rather, the man is made for the woman and the woman for the man. This is set forth clearly in the pure physicality of things. St. Paul calls homosexual acts, meaning contrary to the nature of things. So as regards to the so-called sex reassignment surgery, I must point out that the soul is the form of the body. Now, of course, I can hear the objection that somehow we are not only physical beings, and thus to use simply physical argument is not proper. While this is true, but the body cannot be ignored. The soul is a form of the body. That is to say, our soul is the essence of abilities, gives rise to the structure and physical ability to the body. What is meant by saying that the soul is a form of the body? Well, consider for a moment a glove. What is the form of a glove? What determines how a glove is formed, shaped, or designed? Well, of course, it is the hand. It is both the shape of the hand and its capacities that give rise to the design and function of the glove. A glove with only three fingers or one with eight fingers would be a poor glove indeed. The proper form of the glove is the hand. And it is not just the shape of the hand that dictates the design of a glove. It is also the required function of the hand. Fingers need to move and work together for the hand to achieve its purpose. Man, that's deep right there. I mean, again, this article goes into some deep exegesis. And I don't have time to read all of it, but I think you guys get the picture from the time we came on the air. Romans chapter 1 at 18 says, "For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in righteousness, because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has showed it to them." At birth, God showed it to them. Y'all know the difference between right and wrong. You do. But it says in 20, "For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood with things that are made, even its eternal power of the Godhead, so that they are without excuse." There's no excuse to not believe in the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Really, y'all? Stop lying to yourself. Because that, when they knew God, they glorified him not. They glorified him not as God. Neither were thankful, but became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Uh-oh. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the incorruptible God into an image made like a corruptible man, and to birds and four-footed beasts and creeping things and transgender. No, that's not in scripture, but pretty much. That's what it's saying here. Mm-hmm. No, somebody said, "You just added to the word." No, I didn't. Don't put that on me. 24 says, "Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, the design of their own bodies between themselves." God gave them over to that. Did y'all see that? "Who changed the truth of God into a lie and worshiped and served the creature. Y'all are worshiping the creature more than the creator, who was blessed forever. Amen." It says here. 26, "For this cause God gave them unto the vile affections, for even their women did change the natural use into that which is against nature." He says even women did this. They're not natural anymore. "And likewise also men, leaving their natural use of the woman, burned into their lust one to another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was met." Giving into their lust, men after men, women after women, And even as they did not like the retain God in their knowledge, who gave them over to reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. So God says, you know what? If you want to do it, here, you can have it. It's all yours. So now that they're filled with this unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetous, malice, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whispering, backbiters, haters of God, despite, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God. They know. Notice it says they know a few times here, the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. Not only do the same, but have pleasures in doing them. They enjoy doing all of these things. Although they know God, they pleasured in it. And last and certainly not least, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9. Know ye not that all that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God, but not be not deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate. Y'all know what effeminates are. Nor abusers of themselves. Those are sodomites. All of these are men who not only take objects and put them in their bodies, but they also are having sex with each other. Because I have nurses who I have friends who are nurses, and they tell me that in the emergency room is the most embarrassing place in the hospital because they are busy trying to do surgery to take objects out of men and women's behinds. Men have objects in their rear ends that either they shoved up there or some woman shoved up there for pleasure. And they have to have surgery to get it out of there. And this is what this is saying here. Abusers of themselves with mankind. Then, or thieves or covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers or extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. 11 is very important. Because those of you who have been saved all your life and you're holy and you are without sin and all this other stuff, it says 11, and search for some of you. Some of y'all were just like them people. Because I was some of these. I was a part of some of this stuff. I mean, maybe not in a homosexual lifestyle, but I was a thief. You know what I'm saying? I did some other stuff that I ain't proud of. Because it says search for some of you. But you are washed. But you are sanctified. But you are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of God. All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. And it goes on and on. All right. So some of you were like that. And then God washed you. I don't talk so much hard about homosexual. I mean, I've never been homosexual, but I understand the pain of rejection. I understand the hurt, the desire of wanting to do things. But, you know, I think we have to show these people love, but show them the love of God, not the love of man. There's a difference. God did love us, but he loved, he chases much. So love him like your daddy loved you. I'm going to beat you, but it's going to hurt me more than it hurt you. All right, y'all. I got to get out of here. Dion playing the music. You trying to tell me something. We got another show coming on. And thank God for our new family. Growing here. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. New family's here right after my show. Y'all hang around. This was the Bruce Jenner Effect. Go to Spreaker.com if you want to hear the show again and share it with all your friends. All right. Tomorrow, Jesus. Is he a Republican or a Democrat? Crazy. So that's y'all's show.
You've been listening to the Sir Walter Jones Radio Show. He provides you with a biblical perspective for your everyday life. Stay connected to Sir Walter Jones by visiting him online at www.sirwalterjones.com or on Facebook at www.facebook.com/The Sir Walter Jones Show. Stay tuned until next time with The Sir Walter Jones Show with Sir Walter Jones.
If you can't find any work, I'll put in a good word for you at my job, man.
You ain't got no job, man!
Yeah, one more time. Randy Watson, how about it?
discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart feel lonely and long for heaven? Jesus is my portion, a constant friend is he. His eye is on and I know he watches over me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know he watches. And I know he watches.